And he's characterizing all of these opportunities or possibilities as a function of temperature and the percentage of steam that you can accomplish decomposition of.
And the manufacture of the gas.
Yeah, and he's finding that the better temperature, the best temperature for the purpose is well documented in his in experiments. And you greatly reduce carbon dioxide occurrence. Carbon monoxide
increases
for the purpose of recycling the iron, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
And you get a very high conversion of the steam that you've produced.
Ah, so this reaction, he wants to run it up above 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit.
He wants to run it 1,000 degrees centigrade.
Yeah, so he wants to run up around 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit.
Right.
Which is well within the range of stainless steels that we have today.
Yes, it is. Well, carbon, better than that.
Oh, yeah, graphite. What about the manufacturer?
Well, he's looking here at steam and carbon, if you produce carbon monoxide intentionally, and hydrogen, for which that carbon monoxide can go on and be oxidized. Or you can run this at a different temperature and produce carbon dioxide originally and more hydrogen.
Is the second equation including the water gas shift? Surplus of water?
Well, the point of it is that he's doing this with a catalyst, or we would do it with a catalyst.
Oh, that's right. This is the catalytic process.
It is. But he's investigating in the 1919 time frame, and this very importantly, the opportunities to get the most hydrogen or to get a precursor for recycling iron in the previous chemistry that we examined.
And he gives the formula for the catalyst in the book, too.
Oh, he does. Yes, he does. A family of them. But he's also saying that, they've looked at this and he's looked at and reproduced the experiments and found that you're more likely to have the best economics by running that process at about 1,000 degrees C. And it gives you the opportunity, though, to shift it all to carbon dioxide originally if you have an application for the carbon dioxide.
Mm-hmm. And carbon dioxide is a very sellable commodity.
Well, yeah, you might want to make fizzy water or champagne out of wine. My point in that regard, though, is that he's given you experimentally the references to all these different outcomes that are variables or that are controllables by your selection of temperature and, by the way, pressure. So he's really giving, again, a roadmap to the future, and we've realized many of these advantages as we've carried on this chemistry. He also looks at he's beginning to look at the ways and means that one reaction can cascade heat into another one that wants to eat it or use it, mm-hmm, or take it up as an endothermic.
And again, endothermic is needs heat to run, absorbs.
Right, that's right.
Exothermic releases heat.
Indeed, that's right. And he's looking at the difference between the ways that it was progressed in Britain compared to in Scandinavia.
So coal or coke in a steam reformation process is going to require heat to be added.
Oh, yes.
And iron and aluminum and magnesium in a steam conversion process is exothermic. It gives up heat.
That's true. And he's also saying you can cascade these thermal exchanges from one reaction to the other.
Because you generally have waste heat from one reaction.
Well, or you need heat in another one and you can cascade, mm-hmm, them. You can regenerate one and another. But he's also able, through the relatively few number of pages in this book, to give you a good reference to the actual apparatus,
mm-hmm,
that you can use to run these chemistries.
So all the basics are here.
Yeah, the basics are here.
And here they are.
Here, for instance, is an example where he's saying you can run it as they advanced it in Britain or in the UK, compared, as he'll show later, to how they advanced it in Scandinavia.
Okay. Explain how this reactor works a little bit?
Well, what he's basically saying is that the difference between these English and Swedish systems is in where you introduce and to what bulk or bulk ratio you introduce these reagents. And what he's showing here is how you heat your reagent by introducing air for a while and heat it up by combustion, your carbon source by
combustion. So you put carbon in like charcoal or coke or something.
Yes, and then you burn part of it sacrificially to produce a high temperature.
Lights it and burns it and blows air in to get, like a blacksmith's forge, to get it very, very, very hot.
And then you blow it with steam to get your product that you're really looking for is hydrogen or carbon monoxide and hydrogen. And use that in the chemistry that you need.
You watch your temperature gauge.
And you're continually carrying a thermometer to your production and to your bed to see if you need to change the frequency of blowing oxygen, or air in this instance, to keep your bed at a temperature for best reaction. And remember, he's trying to keep that bed at about 1,000 degrees C.
Mm-hmm.
And that's true both in the English and Swedish approaches.
Okay, we're on.
What's very interesting in terms of comparison with the British approach, the Swedish approach uses somewhat different geometry of their reaction system and a somewhat different reaction rate that is governed by the ratio of air to volume of carbon donating material, carbon donor material. So they've perfected a set of dimensions for their approach in Sweden that is different than the approach in England. And then the book gives some valuation of these two different approaches in terms of dimensions and rate of production of hydrogen and rate of recycling or regenerating the temperature. Remember, it's 1,000 degrees C that's needed for the reaction.
Well, the other thing that's interesting is not only do they give the hearth diameter of just over 5.5 feet, but they give the amount of time for the blast.
Well, they do, and gives you the repeating sequence as a cycle.
Oh, wait.
For the operation.
You said you have nothing from me.
I had nothing from you. You turned your mic way down.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, Eric, make a cut there, okay? We're going to start over that one part. The interesting thing is that they, not only do they show the hearth diameter of being about 5.5 feet across, I mean, so we're talking about something that's your size. I mean, standing there, you can you know, put your arms around it. But here we have the actual times for the blast.
Indeed.
So they blow the air for 2 minutes.
Yep.
And then they blow the steam for about six. So that's the number of minutes you're producing high purity hydrogen.
That's right.
And then they clean it with about 1 more minute of blast and repeat.
Indeed, that's right. And that is the basic difference, is the timing and the dimensions of these two different approaches.
So this is something you can do and control without fancy electronics.
Oh, well, yeah, of course, they did this, absolutely.
I mean, there's barbecues bigger in this thing.
Indeed, that's very true. They did this with what by today's methods was primitive instrumentation, but very successful in terms of producing what they needed at the time.
Yeah, looking through a sight hole at the color of the reaction.
Sure. Or with some, they had started to develop thermocouples, and
oh, yes.
They were doing well.